Good evening, everyone. I welcome you to Spirit of the Mountains, Northern Indigenous Stories of Place. My name is Elaine Alexi, and I work at U Alberta North. I was one of the event coordinators for this event this evening, so I'm very happy to be introducing you all to this wonderful event. Masi Cho to Leon and Ricky for setting the tone of a very important event this evening. I'd like to introduce to you the director of U Alberta North to provide you some opening remarks for the event. I welcome Roger Epp.
Thanks, Elaine, and welcome to all of you. I'm director of U Alberta North. I won't go into the long story of what we are and what we do. I will say that we're really pleased to have been collaborating with the Canadian Mountain Network to bring this event to an Edmonton audience this week as part of International Mountain Day, which here turned into a week and I think a really good week. Really pleased that you are here. Most of all, I'm really pleased and delighted to have our tonight's presenters here, most of them all the way from Tulit’a and other parts in the Sahtu region. I made my first visit to Sahtu in August, and the fish was great. The tour of the town was great, ending up with the sandhill cranes at the town dump. All of it memorable, and so happy that we can return hospitality, and really pleased that you're here. For University of Alberta North, one of the responsibilities that we take seriously is the responsibility to create opportunities like the one tonight, in which Northerners can speak for themselves. Sometimes in Dene, maybe the drum as well, can speak for themselves about the worlds they know, about worlds that should also matter to us, but where we are really the learners. And so we're so honored to have a part of the North really well represented tonight to help us think about mountains and in larger terms about place, all of which we hope will shape a broader and better public understanding that we need to have. So I'm excited for tonight. I think at this point, my role is to get out of the way and let this evening proceed. Thank you very much.
To introduce to you our panelists for this evening and presenters, with the roundtable discussion we're gonna have tonight, we're gonna hear from community members from Tulit’a and Norman Wells and Edmonton. Just to introduce to you, Leon Andrew is a respected htagot’ı elder, leader, and traditional knowledge researcher. He is a member of the Tulit’a Dene Band in the Sahtu region of the Northwest Territories. He is a special advisor to the Sahtu Renewable Resource Board and a member of the Aboriginal Steering Committee for the NWT Water Strategy. He also served as an advisor to the federal and territorial governments on transboundary water negotiations with Alberta. He has assisted with access and benefits negotiations for his community and served on the Canal Heritage Trail Committee for the Tulit’a District during 2004 and 2006. He was a trapper in the Tulit’a area and firsthand experience of both the positive and negative effects of exploration activities on the environment and traditional economy of the NWT. He has provided his research expertise in numerous traditional knowledge studies and has assisted with ethno-archaeological research as part of his NWT ice patch study in the Mackenzie Mountains. He is also an experienced interpreter in Dene and English language. Richard Andrew is an artist, trapper, traditional skills teacher, and member of the Tulit’a Renewable Resource Council. He is skilled in woodwork, carving, drum making, snowshoe making, and traditional fine arts. Throughout the years, he has kept his traditional culture and language very much alive. He continues to tan moose hides, drive a dog team, and hunt and trap. For several years, he has been teaching the youth with songs, signs, and drumming involved in hand games. In 2008, he received the Aboriginal Sport Circle Award in recognition with his work with youth over the years. Deborah Simmons is Executive Director of the Sahtu Renewable Resource Board based in Tulit’a. As a child, she has traveled annually with her family to the Mackenzie Mountains, where her father, Norman Simmons, was conducting doll sheep research in collaboration with the Mountain Dene from Tulit’a. She completed her doctorate in the field of Native Studies at York University, and she has been involved in traditional knowledge research in the Sahtu since 1999, including a study of the htagot’ı, a homeland of the Mountain Dene. She was hired in as an executive director in the spring of 2012 and is assistant professor in Indigenous Studies at the University of Toronto. And lastly, Raymond Yakeleya is award-winning Tulit’a Dene filmmaker, where he has produced through his media company, Earth Magic Media Group, numerous national and international productions as seen on APTN, Bravo TV, and PBS. So welcoming our panelists this evening.
They wanted me to tell a story, and we decided on this story because it takes place in the mountains. We as Dene, we learn a lot from stories and stuff like that. These kind of stories, they told to children and anybody that listened to them. This story is about Wolverine and Yamosa. Yamosa was a person that, for Mountain Dene, he's the one who cleaned the world of dangerous animals and wrong people that people like to kill each another like that. Yamosa once went to visit, and he was traveling, and he went to he got to a camp. When he got to that camp, he met these people there, and they told him, every time people go hunting to the hills, they don't come back. They don't come back. So Yamosa decided to go in that direction to find out why. When he got to the hills, he saw Wolverine. Wolverine was chasing his tail, like you see dogs chase their tail. He was chasing his tail. There's some parts of this I'm leaving out because it's time, that's why. So yeah, he chased his tail, He's chasing his tail. And when Yamosa got to him, he finally saw him, then Yamosa told him, he told him, I saw you coming to me. You can't sneak up to me, he said. But Yamosa said, no, I saw you first. But he didn't tell him, he was telling him, chasing his tail. And then Yamosa was standing there, and he told him, my friend, come, I'll show you, there's lots of good sheep down on the cliff. So they went to walk to the side of the mountain, the canyon there. When they got there, he told him, look down there, you're going to see them. So Yamosa was going there. He knew Wolverine was up to something. So he was prepared. So when he went to look over the hill, he was looking down. And then Wolverine ran up to him, and he pushed him. He threw him down. And Wolverine had already set up these traps for a long time where he'd been killing people. When people come to look for the sheep, when they go hunting. He had bones and horns like that sticking out on the bottom of the cliff canyon. So and then when he pushed him down, he was fall down towards the trap that Wolverine had fixed. When he fell before that, Yamosa has powers too, so he was able to transform himself into a feather. By the time he falling down, just before he hit, he changed himself so that he slowly landed. When he landed there, he was okay, so he turned himself back to human form, I guess. And then he hit his nose. He made blood, and he put it on him. And Wolverine coming on the side, he already had shield. Oh, good, I got him. He's just happy. I could feed my family, he's saying that. So he got him ready. Yamosa wasn't dead, he was just pretending. He closed his eyes, but he brought him home. And then his family members were there, and there was the young ones that was there, daughter and son, and his wife. So they got ready to fix him, skin him. Yamosa took his knife out, he grabbed a knife, but it was a bone knife, not bone. Wooden knife. With that wooden knife, he tried skin, but when he tried, he said, this is not good. Give me my bone knife, he told his wife. His wife went over to get the bone knife, and Yamosa opened his eyes to look around the campfire. He's looking like that. They see club over there. Then he closed his eyes again. Yamosa's daughter was across the fire. He said, Dad, he's alive. I see him, he said. But then he told him, no, he's dead. Look, he lift him up, he drop him. must have just dropped like that. And then he tell him that, then his wife finally found a bone knife. He was trying that. This one not sharp enough to find my flint knife, he said. So his wife went to get the flint knife. He was going to cut him. Then he knew it was sharp enough, so he grabbed that club. He killed the parents. The two young ones, they got away. They ran up on the tree. They climbed the tree. When they climbed the tree, the Maasai shoot an arrow at him. He shoot an arrow, but they're just like this, they're dodging. And so he can't get him. Then he try make fire to make it burn down. And same thing, they went pee on it, it shut off. So, and then the wolverine, the children, they tell him that, Yamosa, if you let us live, we'll give you something, he said. They tell him. Yamosa tell him, well, what can you give me that will be useful for people, he said. And, he said, we'll give you this. And they blew their nose on the tree, they say. They went. That gum, you see, have you ever seen spruce tree? The gum on there, just yellow, really sticky, really good. That one really good, you chew gum, you're good for your throat, for sickness. That he gave that to people. And he said, when you cut a bird feather, I don't know if any of you guys cut bird feathers, but in between it's just like sponge. When you put that gum on there, it's good to put on arrow. It'll help stick the arrow. Yeah, feather. And when he gave them that, Yamosa told them about that. I mean, Wolverine told him about that. So that things like that were told, stories like that about the land, place, how animals help each another, how animals help people, how we came. At one time, they say animals talked. And then, so when he took off, he was taken off, and then those two youngsters were on top of the tree. Wolverine's only that big. So he told them, you guys not going to pass that growth, no more past that, you're going to stay that small from this day forward. And then he tell them, he said, this Wolverine baby, he said, well, if you killed our parents, how are we going to make a living? We don't know how to hunt nothing yet. So he said, well, once in a while, if you get hungry, you could steal from people. So that's why Wolverine steals from people these days. Hunters and trappers don't get really mad because that's a law was given to him too. He got his own law, so that's how it is. Thank you very much.
My name is Leon Andrew. I was born and raised in Tulit’a, in the mountain Dene, in the center of Mackenzie Mountain. Some of us still, we speak our own slavey dialect too. It sounds something like this. Just some of the words that we use in Tulit’a. Ricky is my younger brother, the youngest one. And his talk about prehistoric time, according to our oral history, that's how the world began for us, the story, true that story, how things settled for us, human to live by. But as time went by, you know, I want to touch on my grandfather's drumming. My grandfather is a Tulit’a, and they walk over into Mayo, and they trek back and forth to Mayo, Yukon, and back to Tulit’a. And then one day, they heard about a special person down in the Hani area. So they decided to make this Mooseskin Boat, that you probably see a little bit of it later, and paddle down to see this special man. So they have done that. Spring came, the water thawed out, and they paddled down the river to meet this special person. And this special person talk about the happy place of people that dream in their own ways to gain different kind of information. So that kind of changed the mountain Dene way of thinking and how to respect people and so forth. I'm talking about during the late 1800s. And in the early 1900s, my grandfather, his name is Yatsule Andrew. And he came out with his own, one day he woke up and had his own drum song. And that was one of the songs we sang. And he has produced, I would say, but he said that this has come from the happy place. People give them song to sing for the public. So he does that. And he made up 52 songs, drum song. And some of it is about prayer song, and some is about babies, the mother-to-be. There's a song for them too. And then he talks about everything come to an end, and they have song for that too. On that note, our people learned to respect the land too. And the land had gave us lots. It gave us a lot how we live and survive on the land. Through the hard time when it's 40, 50 below, people still went out and found something to eat. The perspective of the mountain then and since that time have changed, how to treat your neighbor the best you can. And the land, like we have a national park now, it's called Natsincho National Park in the Sahtu Tulit’a district. And Natsincho is one of those prehistoric sites which have provided different kind of power to our people that help them go hunt and so forth. So the land we live on is very important to us. The land provide everything for us. And as of today, a lot of our hunting technique hasn't changed. We still do the things that our ancestors did many years ago. But today, the time has changed a bit. I'm talking about the landscape and the weather. So we have different challenges now. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention. I just wanted you to know about our drumming song and how we're attached to the land. The land means everything to us. It provides for us. And thank you very much for your time.
My name is Raymond Yakeleya. Grew up in Tulit’a. My dad was Kalon Dene, Willow Lake Dene. He moved to Yellowknife when I was maybe about 3.5. He became probably the first Dene gold miner ever to work in a gold mine, blasting and chasing the gold. He did that for 12 years, and so I'm quite proud of that. We moved back to Tulit’a when I was about 8 or 9 years old, and my memories of Tulit’a were very, very not so clear until I came back at 8. And then from the east side of the Mackenzie River, you can look to the west, and there's a beautiful range of mountains. And my granny Harriet, who was a mountain Dene, Shutao Dene, used to tell me stories about that. I used to listen. And one of the things that I always remembered was listening to my mother talking to a blind granny, Granny Tatsy. And Granny Tatsy used to tell my mom stories about a long time ago when the saber-toothed tiger and mastodon and mammoth were still alive, how the people used to survive in those days with, bow and arrow and spears. And I remember Granny Tatsy said, the most dangerous animal that time was what they call the lions. I guess they would be similar to African lions, except North American lions, but bigger. And they used to use Dene as food. Our memory goes back to that timescape, maybe 20, 25,000 years ago. One of my business partners and producer friends was a gentleman by the name of Bill Stewart, and I want to mention his name as Bill is the photographer that shot the Last Mooseskin Boat. But he was in Fort McPherson, where Elaine Alexi came from. And when Bill was with the Fort McPherson Dene, Gwich'in Dene, they told him stories about how they used to hunt, from their hunting stories, how they used to hunt mastodons. And it's a certain technique, because I guess they're bigger than African lions, but really, really, African elephants, but really, really aggressive. So those are the kind of stories I was interested in. And then I ended up becoming a filmmaker, going down to University of Southern California School of Cinema. And George Lucas came out of that year with Star Wars. So I was probably the best of the best. But it showed me what you could become if you had the mind for it, you had the openness. And I realized at that point in time that I wanted to be involved with recording my own people. That was really important for me. I wanted my own people to have a voice, not white men's coming in and making films about us, us making films about ourselves. And how could we do that so we would have a voice in the mainstream that was purely our voice? And I think that was, I was very young. I think I directed my first film at 23, won major prize in San Francisco. That was kind of funny because all of a sudden I was signing autographs, which I never expected to do, right? But it was a really great experience because I got to meet other filmmakers and other Native filmmakers across the States and Canada, and we got to talk and we got to listen to each other. And we all had the same ideas and the same mind in how we were going to make film and how we were going to preserve what was left of our people. This is really important, what I'm going to say. I see Leon to the right of me. Leon is probably the last generation of true Mountain Dene people. After that, there's no more. I hate to say it, but that's what I see. So it's important for us. We have a project on right now to record our people, for us to make our own records. And these are really, really important things to do. I wanted to say something on, and Leon, you should ask him about his grandfather, but in his grandfather was Yatsule, and I heard many beautiful stories about Yatsule, that all his songs came, his 52 songs came by dreams. That's kind of beyond magic. And I heard one beautiful story that I'll relay this before I finish. Somebody told me, and I don't know if it's verified, but Leon can verify it. Leon's dad, there was three boys, I believe, and they were going through the mountains, and they ran into a blizzard, and his grandfather got a song in the middle of a blizzard. And the story that I heard was he stopped the dogs, they built a fire, and they got out their drums, and they started drumming this new song in the midst of a huge blizzard. So that's really quite special. So the sad part about the songs, that now we're starting to lose some of the songs. So I'll talk later about that, but I'll let Debbie say something. Ka masi.
Well, I'm not going to say much because I think the stories that we've just heard stand on their own. I guess what most moved me when we were sitting together, Ricky and Leon and I, this morning, getting prepared for this evening's event, was the way in which Ricky and Leon spoke about those stories as something really truly living in the present. What's really interesting now is to see how those stories are also being are also coming alive through decision-making processes that are happening in the present. Leon spoke about Tie-cho-ka National Park Reserve, which was a Tulit’a Dene initiative. It was a partnership that the community agreed to enter into with Parks Canada, but on their own terms. Now they are recreating that landscape through stories and place names. The community is also in the process of working with people from across the mountains, their relatives, in the Ross River Dene Nation, and also their relatives in Norman Wells, to develop a caribou plan for the mountain caribou in their traditional territory as well. This is a really exciting project that's going to involve hardcore natural science as well as traditional knowledge, and it will again highlight the ecological knowledge that's embodied in place names in that landscape. There are a lot of processes in place that are part of our present now. I think the spirit and intent of what was envisioned by the Dene and Métis people who negotiated the Sahtu Dene and Métis land claim agreement in establishing a cooperative management regime for the environment of the Sahtu region. And so my role as executive director of the Sahtu Renewable Resources Board is to support not just, you know, this objectified understanding of environment and wildlife, but truly a way of life and a complex history relationships with the land that people are practicing now. And I feel really fortunate to be able to kind of follow upon the work that my dad did, learning from Leon's family members and Ricky's family members way back in the 60s when he was working as a Dall sheep biologist in the mountains. He realized then that he had a lot of learning to do from the people who'd been coexisting with the wildlife for so long. So thank you.
We're going to jump into the first film that was shot in the 1950s in Tulit’a region.
This film was been documented back in 57, 58 in that time. It was a Frenchman from Paris, or in that country, in France rather, came across and was up in the Sahtu in Norman Walls area. It met up with a Roman Catholic priest. So he went to Tulit’a. This priest, he said, those mountain Dene are going back into the mountains again. And at that time, I guess he had a little camera that he decided to walk with his people, or my people anyway, and fill in them. They have done that. And they walked. I remember, I was a kid, I remember him, the guy caught up with my parents' camp. When they got a moose there on the lake, as kids we helped dad pull the moose up on the shore. And they waited for my grandpa to show up the following day. And here this guy come up with them. He only spoke French, so we didn't understand what he said. And my grandpa too, you know, nobody speak English that well. So they all spoke Dene language, and I don't know how they communicate, but he came along and he made the film. And so that's what, and in 1996, the elders of Tulit’a wanted to know what happened to the film, if it was possible to retrieve it or find it. So they asked one of the archaeologists in Yellowknife, Tom Andrews, to go find out if we can to track it down. So I guess he promised the elders, yeah, sure, I'll go look for it. And I forget how long it took him, 16 years or so. That period of time to track this guy in Paris or over in France. The guy over there in France is kind enough to give us the film copy that he has.
Original idea was he wanted to study what was going on in the town of Norman Wells, which was a town, a kind of a pioneer town for the oil industry. This guy was trying to present to a Parisian audience, so he knew they wouldn't really be able to tell the difference between the wildlife in the mountains of the Northwest Territories and the wildlife of Banff. And he needed to use some stock footage because apparently, as Tom Andrews puts it, by the time he ever caught up to any wildlife when he was on this trip with the Dene, it was already being eaten, so.
I'd like to introduce for Raymond to talk about his film. Raymond is a filmmaker as well, so. And his film, which was produced in 1982 with the National Film Board, is called The Last Mooseskin Boat.
We made this film in the late 1979. I came home, got a chance to talk to some of the people I wanted to make. I had made my first film called We Remember, and we had won Best Feature at the North American Indian Film Awards in San Francisco. I wanted to make a film about Mountain Dene because my family is also part Mountain Dene. We are from the mountains. And I remember being inspired by my granny too. She would tell me stories, and I was, as I mentioned, you know, with the stories of the lions. I heard stories about saber-tooth tiger, things like that. And how did we connect to it? My granny Harriet used to tell me how beautiful it was in the mountains. And so I thought to myself, well, this is a really good chance to go and find that out. And she was absolutely 100% true. Some of the most beautiful country I've ever seen in my life. I just was, Leon and I were just up there in September, in August, filming at Nasincho. Nasincho is a very holy, sacred place for the mountain Dene. It's a place where you can be granted spiritual powers. So that's what makes it stand out. It's almost like in the Bible time, Mount Sinai, like that. Unequal, on equal terms as that. And so when we got up there, we seen beautiful mountains, lots of game. There are hot springs up there. I think for me, I found the most power. I guess if I were to say I came as close to finding God as I ever could in any place in the world, I found it in nature. I found it in the mountains. I would just leave it at that for myself. I just found some great power there. And anyway, we got a chance to, when I was growing up in Fort Norman, it changed the name to Tulit’a. It's in the Central Northwest Territories. I remember my good friend Paul Andrew, who is younger brother of Leon, older brother of Ricky. The Andrew family used to go into the mountains every fall. And I remember one time I went to said goodbye to Paul, and the next morning went by and the family had gone. So they'd gone early, and we knew we wouldn't see him for a while. I always had that urging that I really, really wanted to go to these mountains. So when I proposed, let's make a film, I talked to my producer friend, Bill Stewart, who was in charge of the Government of the Northwest Territories film unit. He said, yeah, let's do it. Of course, we didn't have any money, but that's but it didn't matter. We still went ahead and we did it. When I think back on it, you know, we should have made more and more films because, like I say, this was I seen with my own eyes a people that were vanishing, a lifestyle that was vanishing, a lifestyle that when people would go and hunt in the mountains seasonally, winter, spring, summer, fall, it's not happening anymore. It's gone. It's finished. People go in the mountains to hunt, but not to live no more. And I remember my granny used to tell me, you know, this past week we had, minus 29 or something? It was pretty cold. In the mountains, when we were up there filming, one morning it was minus 57. And so it really was cold when we were up high. But the people are really tough, very imaginative in how they would survive extreme weather like that. And we heard lots of beautiful stories. So this film I made as a tribute to honor the Shutao Dene. That was my feeling. The sad part that I have to say is that so many of them have passed on. Uncle Gabe, Madeline Itsumitlen, people like that. Bill Stewart himself. There were a number of people that came who were still alive, but the elders have passed on, so that really saddened me, but hopefully we can do more, Leon and I can do further work with our own people and record the records. There's so much knowledge up there, there's so much really, I would say magic is the only way I could best describe it. So anyway, without further ado, I will enjoy the film. We enjoyed making it. And you can be free to ask us questions when it's done.
long time ago, before my father died, the people who lived in these mountains, the Chotodini, would hunt caribou, ptarmigan, moose, rabbit, all kinds of creatures. They used snares and bows and arrows. They hunted for many things they needed to survive, but they hunted only for survival. Not too long ago, when the white people came, the mountain people began to kill a bit more so they would have extra to trade for supplies. Tea, guns, knives, and other things. Before the white man came, the people would make a canoe out of spruce bark and travel down the river. Later, they made moose-skin boats because they were larger and safer. Families could travel together and carry many skins and meat. In the past, we would always be looking for the things we would need to make the boat, preparing the materials, and then when it was time, we would build the boat and leave. In the old days, at this time of the day, at the breaking of dawn, no one was still asleep. The air was filled with happiness. Even the old men would yell, it was so beautiful. I really love it here in these mountains. When I'm away from them, I look back. And when the sun shines on the mountains, I'm filled with longing. I feel that everything that makes me Chotodini is here, calling to me. So I have come back one more time to hunt and live in these mountains and build a moose skin boat. It's been a long time since I have built a boat. But everyone is eager to build this boat and travel down to Fort Norman. I feel alone. But my people must continue to build moose-skin boats. So we will build this one. All of last winter's hides skinned from the moose, all of the meat cut off and the fur scraped off have been dried. And now that we are going to start the boat, the hides are placed in water to soften them. This is where the real building of the boat begins. This time, I, Gay Bettinelli, would be responsible. The others with me, family and friends, young and not so young, were inexperienced and would depend on me a lot. I remember that in the past, everybody worked harder, but they were happier, more fulfilled. They were content. Today, it's not that way. Most of the time when I go out now, I am alone. alone and afraid. Afraid that the young will not remember the ways of the Shutodini. It is important to me that the knowledge of things like the moose skin boat will survive. So I work and teach the young so they will understand why I feel so happy to be in these mountains. So they will remember what happened here. The women work at making the threads from the moose sinew. This thread can be used for many things, but we need it to sew the moose hides together. The wooden parts are carefully chosen. When the grain of the wood is straight, it doesn't break, and that is good. The bow, the keel, and the gunwales, those three are the important pieces. But the bow is the most important. If you don't have a good bow, then how can you make a good boat? Build a boat. If a person has a very good axe, he has an advantage. If he also has a good knife and a three-edged needle, he has every tool he could need. I helped my father, my brother-in-law, and my older brothers as they built boats. That is how I learned. There is so much work to do. The men do some, and the women do some. The women sew quickly. They don't think of it as work, since they know that when they're done, when the boat is built, they'll have a little holiday. They see themselves sitting in the boat riding down the river. They work quickly, but they are careful. When the hides are sewn only once, they can rip open. So the women double stitch every seam. Then it is strong. As we make this boat, I remember other boats that we made every summer. Everyone was always happy. It was always good to build a boat. When I complete this boat, if I find some people to help me, I will build another. When something happens to me, I fear that the Shuto Dene's whole way of life will be gone. But if we teach the young, then our work will not be lost.
Jesus,
this is about broke my toe.
Yeah, but look at this guy.
Dude.
That's gotta come up.
We're at home.
Dog's not bad down there, is it?
Everything must go together in just the right way. The hides must be kept wet, the pieces tight, or the boat will not be strong. It must be strong. Our lives will depend on it. When all the pieces go together, when the boat is complete, when we place it in the water, everyone has a good feeling. Water is very high. We're alone, and with me are others who are inexperienced. In the past, I always had someone to follow. But now, they follow me. Again, I feel alone. I cannot tell the others that I worry. But how am I going to start down the river, this dangerous keel river with the boat? There are rapids and whirlpools to face, many rocks, and the river is always changing. Shallow water, sandbars are something you have to watch for. You have to find a way to keep away from the rocks. The sharp rocks can easily cut the hide. The man doing the steering is the one who will get us back safely. I am that man this time. They all depend on me to know the river. It is a good trip. In the old days, we would stop many times to hunt and fish, to rest. This time, we don't stop very often. But like our ancestors, we make offerings of bullets and other things at the spring at Red Dog Mountain. Offerings to ensure our safety, our safe return, so that the spirits will keep the Keel River from changing too much. Soon, we reach the Mackenzie River, and Fort Norman is near. Our friends come to greet us. They are happy, and so am I. We send messages with our guns, and we are answered. I have been with my people through many things, and we have made the return trip safely. I am thankful, even though I don't know what the future holds for me or my people. Yeah.
What a beautiful film. I'm going to be honest and say that was probably going to be the 100th time I've seen it. Every time I'm just so amazed. Thank you, Raymond, for documenting a piece of history that's so important to Northern Dene. We're going to dive into questions and comments to our panelists. We'll open it up for discussion.
I was just wondering how many years a moose boat would survive. Would it get eaten in the winter by the local animals? Would you have to build another boat the next year?
What would happen is they would use the boat only for one trip down the mountains. This particular boat that the elders made was 9 moose hide. One they talked about was 14. The biggest I heard, I think, came from the Gwich'in territory. They said either about 22. This boat, can't remember the length, but it's about 30, almost 40 feet long. And about 6.5 feet from the bottom to the top. When we went down in the springtime, the waters were really, really swollen. There was one really bad place. They call it in the translation of the Dene word is the elbows. So it's jagged rock like that. And we went down there, and I remember Georgie Pelosi. I counted how many people passed on from this film. There's 6 people that passed on. I always get sad when I watch this because I remember the time up there. We were going to go down. We had a little rubber dinghy with a motor on it, and we were going to bring the boat in the middle and then cut ourselves and then go. And the water was swollen. I remember Georgie saying to me, Raymond, are you scared? And I said, yeah, I am scared. He said, well, what the hell? Let's just go. So after that, everything happened so fast, I really didn't have time to be scared. So it was about the best thing, but I remember in the old days when they talk about when they come down in the springtime, it's really dangerous because of the high water and the fast water. So they just do use it one way to answer your question. And when they get home, they untie it, and then they will tan it to make clothes or whatever. So when they go back up again, they'll take their dogs, and then they'll come down again to do the same thing. So it can only be used one way.
Time doesn't stand still for anybody, and cultures are always changing. What impact at this point, and what do you see in the generations down the road for the North Country, especially with the changes in technology?
When you talk about the new technology today, I think earlier in my statement I said we still practice a lot of our culture, and we still do that. Today's world is different, yeah, entirely. But the story still remains with us, how we have been doing our thing in terms of a Mooseskin boat. Earlier, the lady, too, talked about where do we get the hide to do that. You know, that's something our people always have gone into the hills and on their journey in. In this particular case, the boat that Raymond was talking about is done in the wintertime. So they had access to moose because they go to the lower ground. So it was helpful. In terms of your new technology, I can't say too much about that.
I'd just like to say that I've been privileged to work with new technologies in bridging the knowledge of the elders and some of the knowledge that youth have. And just very recently, in fact, last month, Ricky and Leon were part of a little workshop in Tulit’a where we were using very innovative computer technology where the youth were mapping their own family histories. The elders were sharing stories about that family history, so it became a really exciting coming together. I think that's traditional too. People have always been really innovative and taken up any kind of new means of keeping their who they are and their way of life alive.
Since the last Mooseskin boat was built with Brother Ricky and them, with some other group, they had built another boat there in 2013. A little bit of technology there, I guess, you know, to get inland with by boat and do that part. And you have a better equipment to do the wood and by cutting and so forth. So the technology helped a lot too, framing the frame of the boat.
I have found that in my observation as a filmmaker, we tend to observe a lot. all of these traditions all over the Northwest Territories, I would say all over Canada, amongst the our First Nations, is disappearing. All the skills are eroding. And I say that because if the people were in the mountain, they would have the hunting skills, they would have the trapping skills to be up there. But you go into the mountains, no, the mountains are quiet. When we went up in August, to me, my great sadness was as I was saying, my granny had talked to me a lot. So I had a picture in my mind what the mountains were. When I got to the mountains, they were better than I could even imagine. But the mountains were quiet, and we were filming up there, and I could imagine. There was one story that Leon told me that really struck my heart when he was talking about these two elders that were old, and they couldn't hunt anymore. They could hardly move anymore. The camp hunted moose for them and had meat for them, and they stayed with them for a week, and then they had to basically abandon them because they couldn't care for them. They would have had to have died along the trail, along the many mountain trails, and it really struck me like how, but that was life. There's no other way to sugarcoat it. There was no, how we call, like social service in those days, or no home for the elderly or nothing like that. That was part of our life. And so there must be many stories like that. I hear it amongst the Nuvalluit, amongst the Inuit, you know, where people go out in the middle of the night when the people are starving. There were things that our people also faced starvation up there too. They were really difficult stories, but that's what the people had to face. What I see right now, especially the younger generation coming up, I don't see the skills going to them. I would hope that they would take up education and contribute that way, but I think the best that we can do is work with the elders, record as much as we can on everything, on traditional knowledge, on medicine powers, on healing powers, medicines, whatever that we want, because we have a great vast of knowledge in that way, and that part I know. So I think it's up to us, this generation, to work with the generation that's vanishing. I seen it in my lifetime. I'm 62, and I remember from the time I was about 10 years old. That's only 52 years. It's almost all gone. So that, to me, breaks my heart. I find it really, really sad. When I talk with other First Nations, I always say, you've got your libraries in front of you. Start recording them. It's the best thing you can do. Make records for yourself, because your people know things that are special, that are unique to them, that can help you in the future, that can teach other people. This film has been seen across the country. It teaches kids all the way from BC to Newfoundland. That I'm probably the most proudest about, that our film and TV work can do that. That age is disappearing, and I see it all the time. So that's what I would say to all the First Nations who are listening. It's really true. It's happening.
My question's actually, I seem to recall reading somewhere that with the Mooseskin Boat, there were a lot of them in the 1920s with the flu epidemic. That was at the time when they stopped running so much. And I guess they did continue to build them, but fewer. Is that sort of how the 20th century, like how the Mooseskin Boat sort of fared in the 20th century, that there were a lot and then it was kept alive until what we've seen here?
Our mountain Dene and Sahtu Dene history. The late 1800, early 1900, our people have trekked into the mountain a lot. A lot of time, they made a Mooseskin Boat to come back out with supplies of dry meat and so forth and brought it into the community. Right up till about 1930, 40, and then it kind of slowed down a bit. There's a few groups that's gone back into the hills and have been doing that. One of it is it's on the film. The last time the whole group of Mountain Dene went back into the mountain was back in 1959. And they went in the wintertime, and they went way up there, right close to the Yukon border. And they made five Mooseskin Boats then. That was the last time they'd done that. They made five Mooseskin Boats and family and everything. They came back out to Tulit’a. And that was the last major one they have done. And since then, you know, it's kind of far in between, and the traditional people are kind of passing on, so it slowed down. And then the elders, remaining elders, decided to build one for the purpose of the movie, so that's what happened. And later on, I think Deb's father, too, they were up there and couldn't get out in time, so it melted on them. So they made one themselves to come out. And then, so here and there, a little bit happened. In terms of the mountain Dene for us, this is the first time we talk about our lifestyle, the mountain Dene. The other community around us, in a different dialect, different group, you know, they have a record a lot of their history, but as we haven't done that, since the boat was made, so we talk about the boat then. But now we have this, not the International Park, that really, really explained who we are. So we start telling our story, our side of the story from the mountain Dene people. As of a couple of years, maybe 3 years, you know, we take on the challenge to put our story out there, our history out there, for people to understand who we are.
You mentioned diseases, sicknesses. My uncle, my mom's brother, my uncle Johnny, he told me when he was about 12 years old, I think it was the Spanish flu that hit, 1928. He was just 12 or 13. It was after the boat had arrived in the springtime. In 1 week, about 10 days, they buried, he says he counted 49 elders died in 1 week. And they were dropping everywhere because people had never been sick before. They say when the white man came, this is Uncle Johnny said, when the white man came, they introduced a new way to die, and that was by sickness. So they never had flu or cold or nothing like that. But he said they were building one grave the first day, two graves, and at the end they were burying them in mass graves. So that's like 49 Encyclopedia Britannica of traditional knowledge we lost for people. My granny Harriet said people were floating in the water. They're finding them in the grass like that. So the diseases really, I think, were hard with our people, but they were hard with all First Nations people because we didn't really had no immunization to fight it. So it was hard on the people when I hear about TB, I hear about polio. It really hit northern people hard.
I have a couple of comments. I was wondering about your language to find out if your language is still intact with your young people, if you're able to retain the language. I recognize that all of our cultures across the country are under great threat. You know, a lot of our ways of knowing we lose because of our elders going on to the spirit world. But I also want to make a comment about sometimes we think we lose our knowledge, but it's actually still there. Knowledge keepers that I work with, the women that I work with are younger women, and quite often the way that they know something comes to them spiritually. So the songs, the ways of healing, the ways of knowing is transferred to them from the spirit world, and I'm just wondering if you have that kind of experience in your culture.
Me, I help out in school once in a while, and I find our language too is dying. I guess I'm about the last fluent speaker of my language, to tell you the truth, and I'm not old yet. But I mean, it's going fast, but we're trying hard. Lots of the young boys and that, they still go hunting, go fishing. They don't trap as much, that's dying out too. And lots of the girls, they still work on meat, do stuff like that. We still got some intact, but our language is going fast. They're doing all kind of stuff in school to try save it. They even got tape recorder that they could put on their iPhone, iPod, and learn the language. Yeah, they got all that, but it's going fast.
I'm not a fluent speaker. I understand a lot of it. I should understand more. I need to do that part. On myself, I look at the decline of our languages, and I go back to our school days and with the Catholics. When the Catholics first came to our country, my observation is this. They wanted to have the Dene as part of their parish, so the Catholic priests had to learn Dene language. So once they learned Dene language, it was easy for them to get our people as parishioners. To them, our language is good. But when we go to residential school, they start shaming us. I remember one time when I was 10 years old, I was in a Inuvik school, and one young boy came in from Sax Harbor. He speaks only Inuit language. And he was asking for water, and he used the word for water because he didn't understand English. And the nun came, Sister Ibera was a famous nun, famous for being mean, hit him. And I said to her, why are you hitting him? He said, well, he shouldn't be talking that language. You know right away that they didn't want us to speak our language. And they succeeded in many, many ways in cutting that language cord between the young people and the old people. I remember going back that summer and the bishop, Bishop Pichet, came to, and people would flock. And the Catholic priests are laughing with our elders, and yet here we are as young Dene people. We don't understand what our elders are saying. So all of a sudden, our language was one way good, and when we got to the residential schools, it was no good. My friend Harold, my cousin's over there, and he says, I think they call it the devil's language or something to that effect. Don't speak that devil's language. Your ways are the people or something. It's everything about us was no good. And that's what I remember the most, and I think that's the hardest feelings that I have is our people are great people, like every other people, very decent people. But one culture thought we were not worthy to have our own language. We must all learn English, and I think that's what really more pissed me off than anything else. So that's what I have to say about that. But you were asking about traditional knowledge and how it can be retrieved. Yes, I've heard stories like that. But what Ricky says is true. We are losing our language. One of the bands here in Alberta, the Tsutena Nation, beside Calgary, I think they have only 42 speakers left. They're almost at the end. Maybe in 20 years it'll be there. Which in language in the Northwest Territories, they have 400 speakers. I think what should happen across the country, personally, is there should be a census taken of all the language speakers. It needs to be done. And our people need to do it to know how many we have left. So it's really, really important because everything from the First Nations is Canadian. This is what makes the country Canadian. And those languages are given to us by God, and they need to be saved. We have that responsibility to the Creator to do that.
Just want to touch on what you said about spiritual singing. Us boys, there's six of us, and our father, ever since we were a baby, every morning, every night, he sang for us, each one of us. I don't know if that kind of set into our memory, I suppose. Then we grew up. In 1976, my mother passed on. And the boys, they said, let's go sing our parents' song, our grandfather's song. And we pick up the drum, it just came natural to us. And it always helped us. Until today, we still sing the same song. It belonged to our grandfather, and he talked about a happy place. And every time we sing it, it makes us strong. I don't know why, but it does. And our people enjoy it. We think about spiritual help. That's what the drum does for us and through our songs. The language, yeah, it's kind of like that across Canada, I believe. Even the North, more and more, everybody kind of leaning towards English because that's what people speak and that's how everything's written. If you want to be a driver, that's how you learn. So the trend is moving that way, and sure enough it is. But the method of doing the culture's activity, even through English, can be done. Like Ricky does a lot of that, and he's good at it. The kids enjoy him. Once in a while, he's really funny. I think he's a little bit... I think he's a little shy here. He's not saying too much. Yeah.
Leon was drumming at one time at 5 o'clock in the morning, and he said to me, drumming to him was just like a breakfast for his heart and for his soul, gave him strength. And I never forgot that, so I just wanted to say that's how they feel about the music. It just enlightens them, and it starts their day in the best way. So, I mean, all these songs come from the Creator himself, so that's the composer, so that's all I can say.
I've come with a question of the tale of the mushroom. If you have any tales upon mushrooms.
We were filming in Nasin Cho this in August. We were talking about some plants. I asked Leon, in the mountains where we were, close to the Yukon border, we noticed mushrooms. And so I said to Leon, I said, what does our elders say about mushrooms? And which ones are edible, right? Leon looked at me. He said, only the ones that the squirrel picks is edible. So I said, which one is that? And he said he didn't know. So we didn't know. But, that's something that we have to find out because there's a lot of traditional medicines up there. There's a lot of things that we have yet to discover. I know, for example, one of my uncles told me that years and years ago, he told me that there's a, like a peyote type of plant that they used in the mountains. If you find it, it's poisonous, but you have to cure it. The old medicine men knew how to do that. In mushroom, I can't really tell you. We have to discover which. We have to discover a squirrel's nest and check out what the squirrels got in there, and that would be the one to eat. So that's as much as I can tell you.
I was lucky enough to go to Natsi Cho and Nahani National Parks last summer to do a bit of field work for a fisheries project. And after seeing some of those rivers and your movie tonight, I'm just extremely impressed that someone would navigate a homemade boat down some of those systems. Just wondering, was there other rivers other than the Peel River that would be used by the Mountain Dene people to return from their hunting trips, or was it mostly just the Peel system?
Our people were, was in the Mackenzie Mountain, like Natsi Cho, and the Nahani River, Keel River, and there's Tulit’a River, Mountain River, and Caribou Cry River. They all use those rivers to make moosekin boat. They make it big enough to fit the river that they're traveling on. Sometimes they make small ones for a smaller river, like a couple of moose maybe, a couple of moose height. They have navigate out of the mountain river by themselves on their own term. So they know how to read water. They're really careful what they're doing. And they have survived to tell their story, so I'll leave it there, yeah. They have to use all the most of the river, yeah.
I've had the opportunity to get to know a few sort of young northern leaders over the last little while, and we're in a similar age group. I'm about 30 years old, and I've got some insights into some of the struggles that they have around some of the issues that we're talking about want to live, sort of have traditional experiences and knowledge, but not necessarily... but struggling about making that commitment, about being there in the place and being able to do that. They think through in their minds a lot is this idea of sort of traditional economy versus other economies, economic development, but still trying to maintain those connections to sacred spaces or cultural knowledge. And one of the things that you mentioned earlier that I'd be interested to know your views on your motivations for was this partnership with Parks Canada. There's a lot of talk about these sacred spaces that people do want to spend time in, and that, you know, maybe that could create an opportunity for young people to be more involved in non-traditional employment, but that may have some other traditional kind of connections or benefits. So that's kind of fuzzy phrasing, but I'd just be interested to know more about your experience there.
Natsi Cho and Park Canada have been partnered with our group of people. It was in Tulit’a and Armour Wells. They're made up of the district, the two community, and that's where the park is. And in terms of traditional economy versus wage economy, I don't know how to answer that, you know, because the park itself just starting for us. So if there's potential, sure, we can benefit from there. And that's interesting too, is in terms of for us to go after fur-bearing animal is way too far for us to get in there. It's 100 kilometers almost out there from Tulit’a, so it's very hard to get for us to get in there. But we're allowed to go hunt and do stuff in there. So, but it's very, at the moment, it's very hard to answer that question. You know, it's almost like a political question. So
I think all First Nations are part of the modern world of today. Leon's wife, my relative, was after 136 years, his wife was the first Native woman elected in Parliament for 17 years. That's a major step for Native people. I was telling you when I first started making a film, I went down to California for school. I thought to myself, if I make one film one year, every year, I'll be a lucky man. This is my idea. I was dreaming very, very small. When I first did my first national series, we did 13 half hours. I couldn't believe it. I mean, here I am, you know, designing a series that's running in prime time across the country with APTN and Bravo. Now we have a series with PBS running in 28 states, and now we're going to a new series with PBS. I never would have imagined that a boy from Fort Norman would be doing stuff like that. So, I want to encourage our own Native people very much that they can dream. I was talking to a friend of mine last week. Her brother was an Inuvialuit pilot who flew a 185 out of Inuvik. And in his life, there are two Inuvialuit pilots. One became a jet pilot for Imperial Oil President, flying around a Learjet. The other one was flying a Qantas 747 jet. So we have entered the new world, but it's at the peril of our old worlds and our language. And so I think it's important for us to, as Native people, to talk, because we are losing things. So it's important, you know, what's our priority? Is language our priority? Is it more important for us to learn French than to learn Dene language? I have no connection to French, so I don't care for it. It's important that my granny's language is, and my grandpa's language is saved. Those are the important things. But I think we're trying to make our way in the modern world. We're kind of like doing a balancing act, and I can give you my perspective as an observer. And there must be a way we can do it. I'm not sure what it is. And I think maybe we need to talk about it openly. That's really with elders with us and with young. I think that's the way we have to go.
Our people are very capable of doing the culture activity within our community. They're quite capable to harvest their own food. They can still do that. Right now, our area kind of slowed down, but as far as looking for gathering food, they're very good at that. You know, they can manage. Slow, but that's the way it is. Yeah.
Raymond, this movie, we watched it a few years ago in Yellowknife, and we were like, oh my God, this is the same movie. We're honored to meet you in person as the director. We wanted to congratulate you for this amazing treasure that you're leaving for humanity, since I hope that more, like you said, more films can be done. Thank you.
I want to say that no one person could do it alone. We worked with a really good, great crew from everybody, and everybody contributed. I remember one of the elders saying, when we do things, when we collaborate together, things always turn out better that way. Leon and I have talked about a documentary about the Mountain Dene, a documentary film, but also a book, are now just moving, starting to move through our Tulit’a Dene band for their support. Once we have their support, it becomes easy to find money, and we can do that. And we hope that this enters into the schools throughout the country. I think our people have lots to share. But I also want to say that we also have a project to talk about the origins of the Dene. It seems like the origins, from what we know, come across from Siberia to Alaska, all the way Western Canada, down to Mexico with the Apaches and the Navajo. And there are different tribes in California. And this is something that I've been working with two of the colleagues here that we've talked about. Where did we come from? How did we make it here to North America, to Western North America? As Dene, we would have linguistic similarities, DNA similarities. These are things that are of great interest to us. So that's part of our history. And I think that's what we're looking at right now, from my perspective anyway, as a filmmaker and as a researcher and just somebody who's interested in my own people. So that's been one of the best things that I have found, is other Dene, Apaches or Navajos or Dene from Alaska. You know, we share the same thing, same stories, and it's a beautiful feeling. So I just wanted to say that's some of the things that we're looking at and that we're going to, we are in the process of tackling, I guess, a better word.
So thank you for your words, for the films, for the drumming, all of which put us in the Sahtu, in the mountains, on the Keel River. All of that was amazing. What a gift. Thank you. And also for the sense of the tremendous skill of the Mooseskin Boat. We will remember images and words for a long time. Some of us are going to go home. Some of you are going to go home, and you're going to be pulling out your atlases and maybe getting on the Google, getting a really precise sense of where Tulit’a is after all. So the number of hits out of Edmonton on Tulit’a are going to be exponentially higher than they were yesterday. And that's a good thing. I do want to say, on behalf of University of Alberta North, we want to continue with the kind of programming that you have seen here and other programming that equips and builds a sense of northern affinity and north-facedness in this community and on this campus. I'll invite you to join me thanking our presenters. Thank you very much.